Good evening. Good evening and welcome. My name is Shama Venkateshwar. I am the director of the Public Policy Program, and I am also a distinguished lecturer at the college. Good evening and welcome to everybody. I have the distinct pleasure of coming to work every day at one of the jewels of this institution, the Roosevelt House Public Policy Institute. And this week, we have the honor of convening not one, but two important events to mark International Women's Day tomorrow, March 8th. On Wednesday, a group of distinguished panelists will speak on reproductive rights, our challenges to US and global policies. And our panelists will include Faye Wattleton, former president of Planned Parenthood, Donna Lieberman, the New York Civil Liberties Union, Iris Lopez, a faculty member at CCNY, and the event will be moderated by our Hunter College Anthropology Department Chair, Dr. Ida Susser. I hope you can join us for the second of our important convenings this week. Tonight's event would have been dear to the heart of at least two of its legendary occupants. One of them, you might be surprised to know, was Sarah Delano Roosevelt, Franklin's mother. And as our researchers, and we have a resident historian here, Dr. Deborah Gardner, who researches on the lives of these most important people in this building, we discover more and more important nuggets of information that show just how advanced a woman Sarah was in her own right. Sarah met with civil rights pioneer Mary Bethune right here in this house and became active in charities that benefited New York women in need. Of course, this house was also home to the incomparable daughter-in-law, Eleanor Roosevelt, about whose history and activism no one here tonight needs reminding. And as our special exhibition upstairs, Women Take the Lead from Elizabeth Stanton to Eleanor Roosevelt, Suffrage to Human Rights, shows us, Eleanor herself was a pioneer and so ahead of her time. When women got the vote 96 years ago, she ventured forth from this house into a new world of possibility that was open to her and other women. As we all know, she joined labor movements and labor groups. She affiliated with women's auxiliaries. She enrolled in political organizations. She began very courageously to speak about social injustice and making a huge difference. In short, Eleanor became just the kind of woman who probably would have been an active member of Emily's List. So how very appropriate that when Sarah Roosevelt died in 1941, Franklin made sure that this house, where the New Deal was planned, and from where the president-elect named the first woman to ever serve in the cabinet, Frances Perkins, he made sure that this house would go to Hunter College, a school dedicated then, as now, to advancing the education of brilliant young women who deserved an opportunity to excel in a diverse and welcoming urban environment. So we truly stand on hallowed ground today to welcome a pioneer in her own right. 30 years ago, Ellen Malcolm, a graduate of Hollins College, a small women's institution in Virginia, called a meeting in her house, and then and there founded Emily's List, dedicated to electing pro-choice women to public office. The group has raised more than $350 million to elect pro-choice women's candidates and is committed to pouring $60 million more into the current presidential contest of 2016 before it's over. And dare I say, perhaps we all long for this to be over. Ellen Malcolm will look back 30 years to the birth and the nurturing of a very important organization and its development into an electoral powerhouse. And you will all agree that this house where Eleanor once lived and planned and wrote is the most perfect setting for Ellen's reflection. We will have time for Q&A, and then we will be able to join her upstairs in the Four Freedom Room for a book signing and reception. So now, please join me in welcoming Ellen Malcolm.
Thank you. Well, thank you very much, and it's wonderful to be here. I was sitting there in my chair looking up at this wonderful image of Eleanor, and it reminded me back in the 90s when the Clintons were in the White House and there was all that nonsense about Hillary channeling Eleanor. Remember that? And so I just wanted to say one thing. She's doing just fine, and she's gonna win. And I want to introduce, before I start, my co-conspirator in this effort, a wonderful writer and a good friend and a wonderful feminist, Craig Unger, who's here tonight, lives in New York. When Women Win is a saga of women's emergence as a political force in our country. And, you know, we just made some references to this current presidential campaign and all the craziness that's going on and the gridlock in Congress, and you think, gee, there's no good news in politics. It's all awful. Well, no, it isn't. And a lot of good news came from Emily's List and has come from Emily's List for 30 years. And I think when you read this book, you are gonna see that there is positive progress, there is certainly progress for women, and there is progress for people who have progressive values and want to make a difference. That is what this book is about. It is our story. And so we're going to talk about Emily's List, which actually is a very novel political organization. When we began in 1985, the world was dominated by political action committees, PACs. And they still are. There's literally thousands of PACs. They generally represent special interests. They care about their own legislative agenda. They dole out money so they have their votes and you know, they have their promotion of getting their people, their friends. Well, Emily's List wasn't doing that. We didn't care about promoting a legislative agenda. We actually wanted to help candidates. And so we were very different right from the beginning. We were also different because the PAC world really supports incumbents, people who are running for re-election. And we were doing the unheard of thing in politics of bringing newcomers into office. And so we had to essentially reinvent what a political organization is to be able to bring newcomers, our women, into the office. We were raising money in a very different way. We were not special interest money. We were building a group of small donors that were women. And there hadn't been women giving in politics very much when we began in the 80s. And of course, if you ever doubted we were a little different, all you have to do is listen to our name, Emily's List. I don't think there'd ever been a name like that. And I have to tell you, Craig and Angie both started their organizations in the 90s, and I think they owe me big time. So we're going to talk about some of the Democratic women stars, women who have inspired us, entertained us, brought us to tears, brought us to cheers, women who have made history in our country over and over again. You're going to learn a lot of backstories about Geraldine Ferraro and how it was that Fritz Mondale picked her to be the first woman vice presidential nominee of a major party. You're going to read about that wonderful, funny, brilliant Ann Richards. Remember, she gave that speech at the keynote address at the Democratic National Convention? Well, wait till you hear what happens when she went home and the political establishment of the Democratic Party wanted to have a little chat about who was in charge in Texas. You'll read about Carol Moseley Braun becoming the first African-American woman ever elected to the Senate. The power of a huge number of Democratic women in the Democratic caucus who made Nancy Pelosi the first Democratic or the first woman speaker of the United States. And you'll read a little bit about how Hillary Clinton went from first lady of a small southern state to put 18 million cracks in a glass ceiling and now get ready to be the first woman president of the United States. But first, I want to talk about and share with you a little bit of the story of our first win, an historic win as well, and that is how Barbara Mikulski became the first Democratic woman ever elected to the United States Senate in her own right. It was 1986, and it was the first election of Emily's List. Well, Emily's List began in 1985 with a group of my friends who were, we were just absolutely furious that the political establishment would not take women candidates seriously. We would hear stories all the time about these women that would go to the Old Boys Network and they'd say, I'm a state legislator, my congressman is retiring, the seat is open, I want to go to Congress, I have a political base, I'm well known, people like me, will you make a contribution to help me in my congressional seat? And the guys would lean back with their cigars and, you know, and they'd say, you can't raise any money, and because you can't raise any money, I'm not going to give you any money. Well, women were caught. They were in this terrible, vicious circle. They couldn't raise any money to run their campaigns because the old boys wouldn't cough it up because they didn't believe they could win. So we decided we had to do something about that, and we needed to find a way to raise early money to give our women credibility. And that, of course, is where our name comes from, for those of you who don't know. Well, for those of you who do know, say along with me, Emily stands for Early Money is Like Yeast. We make the dough rise for our women candidates. Now, in that PAC world, the PACs could legally give up to $5,000 in the primary, $5,000 in the general. But that wasn't going to give our women credibility. So what we needed to do was find a way to raise a lot of money for a small number of candidates. We had two women running for the Senate in 1986, Barbara Mikulski and Harriet Woods in Missouri. How could we get a lot of money into those campaigns and not be hampered by this $5,000 contribution limit? We knew people around the country. We'd done the ERA, we'd worked at the National Women's Political Caucus, so we had this idea, if we just told the friends that we had who was running and encourage them to write checks to the candidates, wouldn't they just send it back to us and we just give those contributions to the candidates? And as I would say in those early organizing meetings, including here in New York, if we have 100 people, if we have 1,000 people that write a $100 check made out to Barbara Mikulski, we can raise $100,000 as opposed to the $5,000 we could contribute as a PAC. And people would cheer because it made sense, it meant that women would have power, and we could actually win those races. So right off the bat, this concept of a donor network reinvented political fundraising to give women power in politics. So 1986, we have these two candidates we're going to support. Harriet Woods had run in 1982, and narrowly lost, and unfortunately, she did not win in 1986. But I want to tell you the adventure that was Barbara Mikulski's race for the Senate, because it was a case study for what happened to women and how early money could make a difference. Now, I don't know about you, but when I think, and certainly in the 80s, when I would sort of think of with the image of a United States senator, he would be 6 feet tall, chiseled features, handsome, silver hair. Anybody that remembers Fritz Hollings from South Carolina, you know, the perfect prototype of the United States Senator. Barbara Mikulski was about 4'10", a little stout. Her hair was a little bit messy, a little unruly. She was tough as nails. She had this unbelievable sense of humor. And boy, could she connect with people, because you saw Barbara Mikulski was a real person that was going to make a difference. So she didn't look like a United States senator, but she came out of Baltimore, which is the key place for Democrats in the state of Maryland. At the time, she explained to me, who was a novice at all this, she said, you know, in Maryland, there are 3-to-1 Democratic registration. So It's not the general election that's going to make a difference. What makes a difference in Maryland is who wins the primary. And so I have to go out and beat the two primary opponents. One is Mike Barnes, a congressman from Montgomery County, which is a wealthy suburb of Washington, and Harry Hughes, who is the sitting governor at the time, but he was in a bit of trouble around a savings and loan issue, so he really wasn't going anywhere. So the first polls come out. Barbara has this incredible political base in Baltimore, where she has been on the city council. She has been a 10-year member of the House of Representatives. She is authentic, wonderful, funny, connected Barbara. And the polls come out, and she's got a double-digit lead. This is way before the election. First polls come out. She goes to the old boys. She says, hi, look at the Baltimore Sun poll. I'm way ahead. Will you give me some money? And they say, no. No, Mike Barnes is going to raise all this money. It's just name recognition. I'm sure they're sitting there thinking, you don't look at all like Fritz Hollings. Who are you kidding? And they refuse to give her any money. Again, the credibility gap for women candidates. Well, this time, Wendy Sherman, her campaign manager, called me up and explained what they were going to do and what we needed to do. So she said, what we're going to do is raise enough early money that we can show that Mike Barnes cannot compete with us on the fundraising, and then they'll believe that this double-digit poll result is actually for real and we can win the election. So Ellen, you say you have this Emily's List thing, go make it work. So I thought, okay, fine. So we had about 600 members. We have 3 million now, but we had 600 members at the time. And we sent out our first candidate mailing, and it had Barbara and Harriet, and you got a profile on both of them, and you read about who they were, and we asked you to write a $100 check to both of them. Make it out to Mikulski for Senate, Woods for Senate, and send it back to us. Well, we didn't have a clue what was going to happen. Was it going to work? Would people write one check, two checks, no checks, throw it in the trash, think, no, I think it's a nutty thing? We didn't know. So, from when women win. So the waiting began. Fortunately, we didn't have to wait long. Checks poured into Emily's List almost immediately. And they were not just for $100, but sometimes for $250 or even $1,000, split almost equally between Mikulski and Woods. In just 3 weeks, we raised $22,986 for Woods and $23,916 for Mikulski. That was more than four times what an ordinary $5,000 contribution from a PAC would have been. Our donor and idea actually worked, and we were elated. Barbara had expected her money to come in one fell swoop, but instead it came in gradually. They were like little bundles of joy, Mikulski said. Every week, Wendy, who had become my campaign manager, would get the mail and start opening the envelopes, saying, little Emily's arrived. In early March, the money continued to flow into our office. The quarterly Federal Election Commission filings were due to be reported on March 31st. It was a long-awaited moment for us because it represented an objective, bottom-line assessment of whether Barbara really was competitive in fundraising. When the numbers came in, we were astounded. Barbara had raised $306,000 that quarter, while Barnes had only raised $186,000. A year ago, opponents said she couldn't win votes, but the polls showed she could, said Wendy. Last fall, opponents said she couldn't raise the money, but this quarter showed she could. And what role were we playing? Emily's List members had contributed $60,000 of that total to Barbara. Emily's List is providing the margin of victory, said Mikulski. Now, for the first time, we saw the power of early money working for a woman candidate rather than against her. When all was said and done, Barbara got 53% in an 8-candidate field, leaving Mike Barnes in a distant second place with 29%. Smiling broadly in her acceptance speech, Barbara said, "This is a victory that belongs to everyone. The people were with Mikulski, and Mikulski is with the people." And the people were with Mikulski because in November, she beat Linda Chavez by 22 points and became the first Democratic woman ever elected to the Senate in her own right. So we're off to an amazing start. We made history in our first election. The second election, we did House candidates and reversed a 15-year decline of Democratic women in the House. In 1990, we were the biggest funder of Ann Richards in what was a just awful, nasty primary. And even when she was down double digits in the general election, we stayed with her until she won. And I went to that inauguration, and I proudly walked up the street to the Capitol to watch Ann Richards sworn in as governor of Texas. Then, 1992, and the roof blew off. President Bush appointed Clarence Thomas to the Supreme Court. And Anita Hill came forward, was discovered, and said that Clarence Thomas had sexually harassed her in the workplace. The Senate Judiciary Committee, the chair of the Senate Judiciary Committee, tried to sweep it under the rug. I have a pop quiz for you. Who is the Democratic Senate chair? Oh, you New Yorkers are so smart. Yes. Joe Biden tried to keep anyone from learning about Anita Hill, but Nina Totenberg broke the story on NPR, and as Craig wrote, you can't put the toothpaste back in the tube. Women were outraged as 14 white men on the Senate Judiciary Committee basically sat on their hands on the Democratic side while the Republicans vilified Anita Hill. They attacked her, they said she was crazy, they implied all kinds of horrible reasons why she was doing what she was doing. And women who were now in the workplace living in this Mad Men world said, you know, we know what happens in the workplace, and she is right, and we're the women that understand what it's like to be a working woman in this country. Well, they discovered that there were only two women in the entire United States Senate, and that there were none on the Judiciary Committee. Women in particular became outraged and said, we are going to do everything we can to make sure there are more women in the United States Senate. Emily's List became the focal point for all that activity, because if you wanted to figure out who were the women running for the Senate and what they stood for and who had a chance, Emily's List was the place to go. And we went, in that election cycle, we went sevenfold more in members, from 3,000 to 24,000, and we elected four new Democratic women to the United States Senate and 12 Democratic women to the House of Representatives. The year of the woman was phenomenal. Well, from that base now, we could do more than just raise money for the candidates. We had resources to begin to build a major donor program, which we called the Majority Council, which Judy Loeb here worked with for 18 years, with many of you in this room. We started raising money and enabled us to put together a full-service political operation to help our candidates. We helped them build effective campaigns. We had people on the staff that would advise them and counsel them and assess what they were doing. We had people that were experts on fundraising and media and debate prep, so we'd help them do all of that. We had a big training program. We trained people to be campaign managers and press secretaries and fundraisers. And of course, we'd watch the trainees, and if we saw the very smartest ones, and we'd make sure that our candidates knew when they were looking for someone to hire, which were the people they should go to. We gave them advice on hiring consultants. We helped them learn how to really bargain their media contracts so they didn't lose all their money to the consultants. We raised, by that time, millions of dollars for women candidates. By the mid-90s, we were the biggest financial resource for federal candidates in the country, and we were also, believe it or not, for a while, the biggest political action committee in the country. We looked at the gender gap that had become known as a polling artifact in the 1980 Reagan presidential campaign, And a lot of some of our friends have been trying to get Democrats to pay attention to women voters ever since, and they never would pay any attention. They wanted to win with the white boys that looked just like the candidates, right? They didn't care about the women voters. Well, we realized that gender gap was actually an incredible opportunity for Democratic victory, not just for our women, but for all the Democrats that were running on the ticket. And so in 1996, we launched a national Women Vote campaign, and we've been doing it ever since. We used our marketing expertise to understand different groups of women, what motivated them to vote for Democratic candidates, what persuaded them to go out and vote in low turnout elections. And in 1996, we launched the program with Bill Clinton at our event and helped him get reelected in the 1996 presidential by mobilizing women voters and using that power to elect our women across the country. In 2000, we started reaching out and training people to run for local and state office so we could build a real field team that was going to work on policies in the states and be ready to move up. So by 2004, when I tell you our next story, we had a lot of pieces together that we could do to help our candidates. And I want to give you an example of what happens when it works by talking about how we helped Gwen Moore become the congresswoman from Wisconsin, from Milwaukee, Wisconsin. She represented at first as an assemblywoman and then the first African-American woman in the state Senate, the urban core of Milwaukee. And in 2004, she wanted to run for Congress. It was an open seat. The congressman had retired. There was a front runner of the political establishment, a man named Matt Flynn, who was a very successful lawyer. He had been chair of the Wisconsin Democratic Party. He had the tacit support of the governor and of the most powerful member of the congressional delegation, David Obey. You're getting the gist. The establishment had lined up behind Matt Flynn. Everybody thought he was going to win. And so we went, Gwen then, who had this wonderful political base in her Senate district, had to figure out how to expand her reach, how to reach more voters in this larger congressional district, and how is she going to raise enough money to compete with Matt Flynn? How is this poor woman who had been a single parent, worked her way, had been on welfare and food stamps, worked her way through college, when the neighbors couldn't get any loans, she went out and started a credit union, you know, a real urban organizer. How could this woman take on the political establishment of Wisconsin and win the race from When Women Win? Gwen had been trained by our POP program, but she only had a vague familiarity with Emily's List. For the most part, she dismissed us as a bunch of rich white ladies. I had heard of Emily's List, she said, but I just knew they weren't going to help me. I had heard they didn't help black people. But that was precisely where Gwen was wrong. In fact, more than one-third of the women we have helped elect are women of color. And we were exactly what Gwen needed if she wanted to expand her base. So we immediately assigned Jennifer Pelagia, a young staffer at Emily's List, to work with Gwen. At first, Gwen was standoffish. When Jen told her we would support her, she responded, "Oh, I know, you're the people that are going to make me swim across the English Channel, and when I get to the other side, you're there with a warm towel and a hot chocolate." Jen told Gwen she was exactly what Emily's List was looking for, a committed pro-choice Democratic woman who would be an excellent member of Congress, and wait till she saw what Emily's List could do to help. Gwen was a fascinating candidate. In the state Senate, she had become a powerful voice who had real fire in her belly. She gave startlingly candid speeches on the floor of the state house using her own life as an unwed mother and someone who had been assaulted as a child as an example. "This woman is fantastic," said Jen. "She's one of the smartest people I know. She has a photographic memory. She's crafty. Starting the credit union was typical of the way Gwen thinks. We should have this," and so she went out and did it. She was terrific on issues that were important to her district, such as food stamps and housing. The problem was that none of those issues brought in political money. I've never seen a candidate who had such a small potential fundraising base, and Gwen was almost proud of it. One of her supporters gave her a box of pennies, and I saw Gwen literally counting the pennies, said Jen. She wanted to make the point that that contribution meant as much to her as all the hours spent raising money on the phone from white liberals. So suddenly you had an understated, mild-mannered young white woman from the Midwest, Jen, trying to tell this unstoppably powerful black woman that what she needed to do. It wasn't easy. When it came to debating, Gwen's rhetoric was not exactly geared to the affluent white liberal donor she needed. As Gwen put it, her style was street. I know how to argue, she said. I know the facts. But before Emily, my style was something like this. To demonstrate, Gwen slowly took off her glasses and looked directly at me as if I was her opponent on a televised political debate. Kiss my ass, muttered Trucker. I'm gonna tell you how it is. And then she burst into laughter. Of course, Gwen was putting us on. She was much too smart to blow up her own campaign. But just in case, we made sure Gwen's rhetorical skills were refined somewhat by the time the election was over. Amazingly, it all began to work. Emily's list legally couldn't do the actual work of the campaigns, fundraising, organizing, and the like, but we had a continuing interest in assessing our races. Of course, a critical part of that process was advising staff, many of whom were new to their jobs, on what was working and what wasn't. So we sent staffers to monitor Gwen's field operations and her get-out-the-vote process, help her with debate prep, and raise money from progressive donors. In the end, we sent so many staffers from Emily's list that Gwen used the name Emily as a prefix for all of them. Emily Jen, Emily Dave, Emily Heather, and so forth. I was proud to be known as Emily Ellen. Gwen was a powerful and much-loved candidate, but it's also true that our relationship with her was a terrifically productive political marriage. In the last reporting period before the September primary, Gwen had raised $354,000, four times as much as Matt Flynn. And more than 200,000 of that came from our members. In late August, Women Vote went on TV with an issue ad praising Gwen for her work on education. We were at her side every step of the way. When the votes came in on September 15th, Gwen earned her win in what can only be described as a colossal landslide, winning 64% of the vote to 25% for Flynn. It was hard to remember that just a few months earlier, Flynn had been a prohibitive favorite. So it's a different world today. It's different for women candidates, and it's different because all of you that are Emily's List members and Emily's List staff work to make it different for women. In our 30 years now, we've helped elect 11 women governors, including, of course, Ann Richards. There were 12 Democratic women in the House when we started doing House candidates in 1988. We've added 110 women to the House since then. And our poor, lonely Senate, we've added 19 pro-choice Democratic women to the United States Senate. Now, with all that, you know, we're pretty used to seeing women in political office and in the Congress, and we think there are lots of them. Unfortunately, we're still only at 18%. But I gotta tell you something, the progress is almost all on the Democratic side. In 1988, there were 12 Democratic women and 11 Republican women in the House of Representatives. Today, at that time, women were about 5% of both those party caucuses, or 5% of Congress. Today, Democratic women are about a third of the Democrats in the Congress. Huge increase. Republican women have gone from 5% to 9%. In 30 years, they have made no progress. So when you see all these women in Congress, three-quarters of them now are Democrats. And those are women that are fighting our fights and working on our issues and making a tremendous difference. One of the differences they've made, and this is just one little piece of the presidential election, is that voters now know what it is when they see a woman run for office. In 1985, when we started, voters had no reference points for what a woman candidate was. And in their discomfort and trying to figure out what would it mean that a woman would run for the Congress, what would she sound like, what would she do when she got in office, and they'd resort to all these gender stereotypes, and the women would get these ridiculous questions. Well, it's very nice you're running, but, you know, where's your husband? And who's home getting dinner ready? And who does the grocery shopping? I mean, seriously, what roles did women have other than that? Now they've seen women in almost every state be elected to Congress. They've seen women compete in some of the toughest races in the country. And as they've become more and more familiar with it, the gender stereotypes begin to disappear, and they judge women candidates on who they are, what they stand for, and what they want to do. So when you look at the presidential now, this is one little piece of the equation of how Emily's List has really tried to prepare the way for a woman running for president of the United States. I'm not saying gender has totally disappeared out of this election, but it's a far cry from where it was in 1985. But in the end, we know how difficult this presidential campaign is going to be, because nobody understands the difficulty of women making history and politics better than the members, the staff, and the candidates of Emily's List. We know how tough it can be, but we also know how to win. And we're going to win in 2016. Thank you. All right, we got some questions? Yes.
Is it true that women are not that anxious to support Hillary?
No, it's not true. In fact, if you look at all the polling data, you see that women are the core of Hillary's support. There's been a lot of talk in the press about millennial women, but across the board, the gender gap is strong and powerful on behalf of Hillary Clinton. You see it in the nominating process as we've gone through a lot of these primary states. And you are really going to see it if Donald Trump is running against Hillary Clinton in the general election. So women are for Hillary, and the reason they're for Hillary is because they understand that she gets what they're dealing with in their lives. When she talks about paid leave and all the different issues, the agenda that she's speaking, she is talking to women in a way that women have never really heard the same in a presidential election. She has taken issues that are important to women and made it a cornerstone of the dialogue of what's happening in a presidential campaign. And women hear that, they appreciate that, and they respond. Yeah. There's a gentleman over there.
Emily's List do any kind of vetting in terms of the candidate, the woman candidate? And if so, how do you reconcile if there are two women who are Democratic progressives that are running?
First off, I at first thought you said, did we do any betting? I thought, well, that's an interesting idea. If we want to take side bets on the presidential, we could do that. No, we do vetting. Though our criteria is we support pro-choice Democratic women who have a realistic chance of winning the race. They don't have to be the front runner, but there has to be a path to victory. They have to have a campaign. They've got to have a little money in the bank. They've got to have a track record and be able to articulate a vision of where they're going. It has to be a race where it makes sense for a Democrat to run. So we do a whole process of figuring that out. We then give that information to the members, as well as all kinds of positions on different kinds of issues. And then the individual members decide what they want to do with that information, which is the thing I love about Emily's List. We're sort of like your political staff. So you come in and you tell us, I want more women in office and I want good candidates, and we give you the information. We tell you, here's who's running that are pro-choice Democratic women. Here who has a realistic chance. Here's what they stand for. Here's the dynamics of the race. You invest in whoever you want. And people write out their checks to the candidates they like, send them back to us, and we just forward those contributions onto the campaign. So there's a very clear process of empowerment, basically, of our community or group of members. We are doing what is now done on the internet, only we invented it 30 years ago through direct mail, snail mail, right, and putting together a small number of people that were maximizing what they were doing. Now, two women in a race. Well, I'm in the first place where we had to really deal with that. That was in 92 when Elizabeth Holtzman and Geraldine Ferraro were running for the United States Senate. And I thought, well, we got to start this someday, but do we have to start with those two race, that race in particular? Because he were two just iconic women who had done so much for women. And it was just really a shame that they were running against each other in this primary. Well, we initiated a process. I actually got some people independent of the steering committee because a lot of us knew Jerry particularly. And we came up with the process that we still use to today. Essentially, if it's in our judgment that if we don't make a decision, if we don't choose one of the women, we will lose the opportunity to put a woman in office, then we will decide to get in. And we get in for the strongest candidate to win, not just the primary, but the general election, because that's what this is all about. So we go through a very thorough process. We often do our own polling. We agonize. We tear out our hair. We look at all the numbers. We talk to people in the districts. And at the end of the day, we will make decisions. And then when we make a decision, we are all in for that candidate because we know there are very few opportunities to put newcomers in. And if we see an opportunity, we are going to do everything we can to win that race.
Yeah. I'd like to follow up on the first question. Mm-hmm. Not that I'm contradicting anything you've said about Hillary Clinton, but there is a discussion among what they call millennials, younger women who see women running for office almost as a new normal, as opposed to something my generation thought, wow, the first woman running for this or the first woman running right. for that, that was amazing. And I run the Shirley Chisholm Project at Brooklyn College, and so I know what it was, at least from all the work I did on Shirley Chisholm, what an extraordinary feat that was. My question is really, how is Emily's List trying to reach out and educate this generation of younger women to understand the importance of the work that you do? So that while it may seem normal for them or no big deal to have a woman elected to the Senate or to the House or to get on the Supreme Court, how important it really is that this work continue?
Well, let me answer that a couple of ways. My initial reaction, I was very unhappy about all this talk about millennial women, and then I went back and remembered who I was and where I was when I was young. And I graduated from college in 1969, as did Hillary, and it was the height of the anti-war movement. I had my first political experience hopping in a car with a bunch of friends, and we drove up to Philadelphia to knock on doors for Gene McCarthy. And, Clean Gene was my guy because I wanted to end the war, and I didn't know much of anything about politics, but boy, was I excited. I thought that our generation was changing the world. We were doing things differently. We understood things differently. We were going to change the culture. We were going to change the politics. We were going to end the war. We were going to take care of civil rights and poverty. And it was wonderful to feel that I was part of something larger than myself. I think there are a lot of millennials right now who feel the burn, and I think it's fabulous. Because those same young people are having the same experience I had helping Jean McCarthy. And I hope a lot stick with it, and a lot of them go out and get active in progressive politics, and maybe some will start some new organizations. And I hope out there knocking on doors for Bernie Sanders, the couple of women that are going to be president of the United States. Now, having said that, we are reaching out to millennials, and we are just starting a new program. You know, it's when you listen to the media, you think no younger women are for Hillary, and then you go to campaign for it, and you see all these young women in the offices and canvassing, and, you know, I was in New Hampshire and Iowa. I mean, there are all these great young women, and so we're going to start, we hope, a conversation with them to talk about why they love Hillary, why they think it's important. I don't think they need a lecture from me. They could buy the book if they want. That would be nice. I don't think that they need a lecture from me. I think they need to have a conversation about Hillary. And I think basically when this nomination process is over, just as we did in 2008, which was a lot different and hard fought more than this, we're going to come together. Because at the end of the day, it's going to be our nominee versus Donald Trump or Ted Cruz, and we better the hell come together. So we'll get all that energy and put it on our side. Yeah.
What do you see happening?
But let me get you a mic here. Are you hearing me? I'm not really talking into this mic very well. It's my New Jersey bellow. What's the need of a mic?
What, if anything, are you seeing happening in the states with 30 Republican governors and a lot of Republican legislatures, the horrible abortion restrictions and these mm-hmm. ghastly voter ID laws are just terrible? Obviously, I know you do a lot of work in the states with representatives mm-hmm. and so on. Is there anything we can be hopeful about? Is that starting to move in the Democratic direction?
Well, yes. And, you know, I think as Democrats and people that have listened to me talk for years have heard me talk about how important it is to invest in building an infrastructure in the states. And, you know, we're always last minute, all of a sudden, right before redistricting, everybody goes, oh, my God, the states, we should do something. And, you know, it's usually too late and too little. And Emily's list is doing what we can, but we need to really maximize that effort. And I am very proud of the work we have done to help not just our women, but to help the guys in the states try to create majorities there. We have a lot more to do. And one of the best things that could come from this election is if we can win and win big, is to really pick up a lot of these legislatures and a lot of state control. What the right is doing against women is outrageous, and it is unending, unrelenting, and it is now, to me, getting like the gun lobby, in that they're kind of outdoing themselves with ridiculous, absurd restrictions, trying to show my restrictions bigger than your restriction, right? So I think women hear that. I know certainly in 2012, we started to get a huge backlash from actually younger women who all of a sudden woke up and said, wait a minute, you know, I thought this was all settled a long time ago. So I think we need to do more in the states. I think when you support Emily's list itself, you are investing in the future of state legislative candidates. It's important work, and we need to take back control of government at all levels. I see a hand somewhere back there. Why don't we do two more? There and then Deborah over here.
So I'm a Texan, and I was a college student working on Ann Richards' campaign. Uh-huh. And now watched, sadly, from up here as Wendy Davis gave Texas another shot to have a woman in office there. Texas didn't seem to be able to get its women really behind Wendy. We saw a lot of slut-shaming and a lot of very critical language of the way she looked, very little focus mm-hmm. on the fact that we do have all these abortion restrictions now in Texas and all these things happening. So what do you think could have been done in Texas, and what do you think could be done in other parts of the South to get women more solidly behind women candidates?
You know, I'm going to do a sort of an unusual response to that question and talk a little bit about social change. And I do that, again, smiling at this wonderful Eleanor Roosevelt. I think social change in this country is an ongoing process. It is not something where you win and you say thank you very much and you go home and that was great. And for me, what I learned, I worked with a woman named Esther Peterson who worked with Eleanor Roosevelt when she was the first head of the Commission on the Status of Women, and Esther was the executive director. And I met Esther and Millie Jeffrey from the chair of the National Women's Political Caucus. They had both been very involved in the labor movement. They had both done work on civil rights. Esther was a big consumer advocate, one of the leading first consumer advocates. And it showed me that there is a progressive stream of values that goes in and out of politics forever, since the beginning of our country. It emerges with different issues. Sometimes it may be the labor movement issues. Sometimes it may be environmental issues or women's issues. And people will come into that process depending on those issues and connect with it. But one thing about that is that it isn't linear. You can't celebrate victory and stop. You have to constantly, constantly keep fighting. What happened in Texas is a good example of that. Ann came in, appointed all kinds of women to office and minorities that had never seen the halls of power in that state. There wasn't enough infrastructure behind her. When Bush came in, the Republicans took the government back. It had become a Republican state and basically created a disaster for women. And there are pockets of women that are fighting, but it's going to take a long investment reaching out to broaden the electorate to the Hispanic community, getting women energized and political for organizations like Annie's List, to be able to change that. And I think it is a real lesson to all of us that you can't just say, hooray for Ann, that's great, and go home. And you can't say, oh God, Ann lost, and go home. If you really care about social change, you stick with it when it's winning, and you stick with it when it's losing, and you come back and you fight, and over time, you end up with a third of the Congress on the Democratic side being women. Deborah.
A comment about the state level. One of the things that we've done here in New York is created Eleanor's Legacy, which basically focuses on electing. It's basically a copy of Emily's List at the state level. And what we try to do is elect pro-choice Democratic women on the state level here in New York, and we're having quite a significant success. It's slow, takes a long time, but it has been working, and it continues to be working, and that's something that needs to be done in every state, frankly. I just came back from Arkansas, which is a little more difficult, but I think that your point is incredibly well taken. And one of the things that I think is happening, and I'd like your comment, is it seems to me that one of the things that we have not done well in recent times is really talked very clearly about what the Democratic Party stands for. And I think we are doing that in this campaign in a much clearer way. Mm-hmm. Whereas, you know, when I go to Arkansas, the Republican Party stands for guns, God, a subtext of race, clearly, stay out of my hair.
And demonizing any progressive policies
demonizing
towards women.
Demonizing any government, period, mm-hmm. and everything, you know. And we have not really been as clear, I think, about what we stand for, but I do believe that that is coming out in this election in a way that it hasn't mm-hmm. in recent elections.
I agree. And, it's about time we had that conversation and got out of this media stuff. The question is whether or not we're going to be able to. And the fascinating and the horrifying part of this Trump phenomenon really is who is going to listen. And I think it's going to be a fascinating process to watch over the next months. I believe that, obviously I think that the nomination is moving along rapidly towards Hillary. And I do think that her ability to talk about what is really going on in people's lives and have real specific solutions. I have listened to that Donald Trump, and I swear to God, I can't tell you one policy he's in favor with other than the wall in Mexico. It's unbelievable. And every time Rubio tries to press him or whatever on what is your position on this issue, when he gets backed into the, I really have to come up with a position, he attacks. So I don't think he can keep pulling that off in the general election. I think at some point people are going to say, hey, you want to be president of the United States? What the hell are you going to do when you get there? Well, Hillary knows exactly what she wants to do when she gets there. And, in 2008, I was very excited in that very difficult circumstance where we had these two wonderful candidates to choose from, but I loved Hillary, and I thought she was just doing a great job, and I wanted to elect the first woman president. But right now, when I look at what's going on in this country, and I see the gridlock and the fighting and the whatever, I want Hillary to be president. I want a Democrat in that White House that is going to bring people together, that is going to work with the women. Look at what the women have done in terms of being able to get things done. Patty Murray worked with Paul Ryan and got the first budget passed in I don't know how many years. Debbie Stabenow, we talk about this in the book. Debbie Stabenow went and basically reached out to the members of the Agricultural Committee when she became chair, and she said to us, I know what was my priority. I wanted to protect food stamps. That's part of the agricultural budget. But I was willing to go and hear what the Republicans wanted to do, too. And I don't think politics has to be win-loss. I think you can do politics where everybody comes out with something in a victory. And she did, and she put that together, and they had the first agricultural bill, again, in years that passed. So I think with the women that are now in Congress, if we have Hillary there who understands this process better than anyone I know, I really think we can start making change in this country, and I'm looking forward to that, and I'm going to work real hard to make that happen. So I want to thank you all for coming. I just want to close with one big hug and a thank you for all the members of Emily's List. Those of you that have been on this journey with us, or some of the journey, or all of the journey, this is your book of what you've done positive in politics, how you have changed this country in a very important way. So I hope you read it, you love it, and you just remember all kinds of great things that happened in the past, and realize that women have power in our country, and the country is better because of it. So thank you all very much.